What's it like working together now versus then?
Coming home from a long journey.
Are you being silly? Because that's a really nice thing to say.
No, it was.
It's probably been as satisfying an experience as I've ever had. Welcome to Entertainment Weekly's Around the Table with the Adam Project. I feel like this is the first time all of us have actually been together, right? Because we shot this movie. We shot this movie in little pockets. Like there was
the
Jen
and Walker
end.
And Ryan stuff at the end, and we had Mark for a chunk, and we had Zoe for a chunk, but so
a small chunk. The quarantine was a big chunk.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, that was longer than the shoot. Yeah.
Literally, some of you quarantined longer than the shoot, because it was, what, 2 weeks then?
Yeah, 2 weeks of shooting.
2 weeks, come to Canada.
I shot a week and a half, and I quarantined for 2 weeks.
See, I quarantined twice, as did Sean.
Yep.
And I was there with my whole family, so I was in there with my three little kids.
So really, it was just an exercise in not taking my life with fire.
I was cooking a lot. I was doing a lot of things. I was cooking, I was mothering a lot, I was crying a lot too, because God, like, everything was getting me emotional. I would see a commercial and I was emotional. And
it was like a Men's Warehouse commercial too. Like, wasn't even a good one.
It wasn't. It really wasn't.
You're gonna like the way you look, I guarantee it. Oh my God, that was beautiful.
Yeah, but this movie, I feel like this movie is one of the first full features to get shot in the COVID era with a quarantine when you arrived. Then if you wanted to go home for Christmas, we quarantined again. I mean, there's no wood
no
that I can knock on.
Right?
Not a single positive case on a 75-day movie shoot.
There was one.
There was one?
The guy who cleaned my trailer.
Okay.
Oh.
I came in and they're like, hey, we got to tell you something. The guy who's disinfecting your trailer
is infected.
Has COVID.
So we'll be getting you a new trailer? So, is that the spirit
so
of it?
So what is, does that mean?
Are you and he karaoke partners? Is there something you can tell us that
happened?
Maybe?
But I didn't get it.
Yeah, we got lucky.
Knock on wood again.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
Whoa. I don't think we should be out here. Who's there?
Take it easy.
Ah!
Or, you know, fall down and scream.
You knew how to get into my dad's garage. You knew how to close the fridge. We have the same scar.
Right here.
And you're wearing my dad's watch.
This watch.
You're me. Holy shit.
That's classified, but yes. I once was. Where are you going?
But I feel lucky because I feel like when we put this cast together, everyone kind of came to this for different reasons, but with something that felt true to them personally.
Yeah.
I know for Ryan and I, it started with that idea of, well, what if you could revisit your own history? And what if you could maybe have a chance at making peace with it? Mm-hmm. And I remember, Jen, when you and I first spoke, and this idea of mothering a son, especially a, you know, preteen boy, and I think you're in the midst of that yourself, and the idea of meeting your own son grown up. I remember, I feel
just
like our initial phone call got emotional.
Phone call. Yeah, I remember feeling like, oh gosh, Jen.
And I remember saying to Jen, I'm gonna send you the script, and you said to me, well, you can send it, but it's a yes. Aww. So it's gonna be a yes. We can go through the I'll read it thing, but it's gonna end up with the same
yes. That
was
similar to how I came about. David Ellison, who runs Skydance, you know, this is one of the studios behind the film, pitched it to me first, and then said, I'll send you the script. And I said, please send the script, but I'm doing this, we're doing this. Mm-hmm. Now I have to go beg, plead, and steal to get Sean Levy to do it. The
none
next
of that,
step was.
None of
yeah.
that was necessary. This one spoke to me
but
instantly.
That bar scene in particular, there's a line in there that is from my real life, which is that boys always come back for their mamas. And that's very true. When my dad passed away, I'm one of four boys. And it was just like this circling the wagons around my mom. Like, we really all kind of came back for her in a way that, you know, I know was incredibly meaningful to her, and to this day she still talks about it, but that's a real life thing, which is that boys, they do, they come back for their mamas.
What's going on, honey? It's the third time you've been suspended for fighting.
I
know, you'd think I'd be better at it by now.
I don't understand you.
Dad would.
I miss him too, you know. But son, you need to think about your future. Because it's coming. Sooner than you think.
And Walker, was this your first movie? I've just decided to moderate this chat myself. But wasn't it actually your first movie?
Yes, and they deleted the whole first scene because of me, too.
Well, they is me, and they is also Ryan. And yes, I did delete it, otherwise known as editing it out. And yes, it was bad. And it was bad not because you were bad, but because I feel like both of us were finding the movie still. It was our first
day shooting. But that's totally normal.
Yeah. I over-rehearsed it so much, though.
That's the thing, right? Over-rehearsing?
And whatever you've auditioned with is always, like, when you get there to shoot it, you just, it's horrible.
Your favorite scene is always the worst one. You're like, oh, my God, I sucked at it. That's my favorite scene.
What was it like when you met these big-time actors, Walker? Do you remember?
It's weird. I watched Endgame, and I watched all the Avengers movies and all that kind of stuff, so it's weird not seeing, like, Professor Hulk. Green and stuff.
You couldn't put the friggin' mocap on for the kid. He's like 12, man. I mean, give me a break.
It was weird seeing him with a beard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a clip-on. I had a beard on for a little bit.
Yeah. Do we want to talk about the fact that you had all of Deadpool memorized?
We knew when we saw Walker, we had seen hundreds of kids, and we knew when we found Walker that he was special and talented, but we didn't know that he was a sick fan of Deadpool. So he showed up ready to with the chops, but he can channel Ryan.
Yeah.
Because he
had recorded it.
I recorded. No. I just turned the camera around and I went Deadpool 2 go, and he just he does everything. Not just that, he does like improvised stage direction and the expositional lines.
I watched it like a million times before every audition I did.
Now, would your parents kind of point out that it's a hard R?
Oh yeah. Okay.
But you were just like didn't care.
When I was this kid's age. I watched everything.
Me too.
Like
those
every
were the
80s. Rated R movie that you Porky's, you know, all these like things that you should never see in a million years.
Revenge of the Nerds, all of those.
Yeah.
Ten.
Yes. Ten. Yes. Oh, Bo Derek. Wow.
Ted 2?
Ted 2?
Ted 2? Well, yes,
sure.
Keep going,
the Prairie,
and then
the
Little House on the Prairie the next season.
Oh, God.
And then Little Town on the Prairie.
No.
This is so odd.
And not Highway to Heaven.
No.
She went even into Highway to Heaven.
Time travel exists. This world, our world, everything has already been changed. That's why we're gonna put the genie back in the bottle.
Adam?
Dad.
Well, this movie is kind of everything I love because it's got this big wish fulfillment premise, but it's also an actor's piece and everyone got meat on the bone to play. And yeah, that there's a mixture of like spectacle, fantasy and comedy and above all, heart. I was in Los Angeles with Ryan a couple weeks ago finishing the movie and I said to him when the movie ended, I said, this is exactly the movie I've been waiting to make. Something that takes all of those influences and all those sensibilities and is just about audience delight and hopefully human connection. And that it can be kind of huge and filled with spectacle, but about things that resonate. It's probably been as satisfying an experience as I've ever had.
And you, Sean does something
everything
unique.
Everything you're saying, it's all there.
Yeah, I think Sean does something unique that is the reason I want to do every movie I could ever do with him, which is that he's not unlike Spielberg does too. You're in the theater watching the movie while you're making it. And you see it on screen.
Do you know what's
you are
so
sitting
crazy,
there in
Ryan?
The theater watching the movie as you're shooting it, and it's, you can tell.
The one time I worked with Spielberg, he produced my movie Real Steel, and he turned to me one day and he said, "You direct like you're sitting in the audience."
Yeah.
Oh, and wow. He said those words to me, and I was
like, "Well, you know, great minds, Sean."
I mean, apparently so. But that was kind of, I have no other talent, but I do have that one instinct, and that's where I make all my decisions from. So
you have good hair.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. I have good hair. And now we get to what really matters.
Yeah, exactly.
The hair.
So you don't need to talk about my talent.
He takes that thing off like a hat at the end of the night. You know that, right?
Is the mesh showing now?
Yeah, the lace is. Okay.
So can I ask a question? Can you guys talk about the moment you decided to do the scene like last minute in Magic Hour instead of,
Zoe?
My favorite scene in the movie, which I've talked about already ad nauseum. And last minute you decided, you know what, we're just gonna go for it. Can you talk about it?
I love that.
Because it has the urgency and it has, it feels so real and so, it's so beautiful.
And it's so much darker in real life than it is on camera in the movie. Like it was getting dark.
We were losing sunlight.
Just to set the table, we're filming at a cabin that we built in the middle of nowhere on a lake. Yeah. And we were supposed to film one scene on this day and the farewell scene the next day. And it's like 4 o'clock. There's about 35 minutes left of sunlight and we're ready to wrap up the day. And all of a sudden we're like, should we just do that scene now? Let's just do it.
Because there's like a fog over the water.
Yeah, no, it was
There's a mist. The light was perfect. It felt spooky and eerie and
shooting that emotional scene by the benches, by the picnic table, it just, I don't know if it was like the last two takes or finally there's this little surge of energy where everything, like you get the moment and you get that sense of urgency. And I think we all looked at each other and we kind of had that adrenaline.
Yes.
And it's like,
you definitely had that adrenaline. Zoe grabs me at one point and throws me against the truck, and it was like Hulk doing it. It was just like, oh, God.
And it was, and nobody said no. You know, we were all like, yeah, let's do it.
Let's just do it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I love that about the filmmakers in Vancouver, because I feel like they are, whenever I shoot with the crews in Vancouver, I feel like they are artists and they just want to make the movie as good as
they're excited, and they're with you
and they love actors.
Because the crew could have said, you know what, we're tired. And everyone rallied.
Yeah.
And we did the whole scene in like two shots.
Also, when it rains 364 and a half days a year, when you get that one little moment, everybody's ready to go. And what I love about moments like that too is that nobody, we didn't really know the scene perfectly, and that sort of in a weird way, I think, helps. You mentioned that earlier a little bit, but not totally knowing it, and it makes it sort of much more alive, I think.
Absolutely. We knew the beat before. And sometimes like the beat before, like prepping that beat before in your trailer is exhausting. You have this panic attack, but if you just got off that beat before and you know where you're going because you know where you've been, I like the fact that we'd never held each other back, that we went for it, and I don't think we would have achieved the same result had we shot it the next day.
I think we only did it because then you get in your head.
No, it was two takes.
Two takes, and then
we knew we had it, and
we debated for a while in the edit room which one to use because they're both great. They're both different.
But that's I mean, it's so fun and lovely to let the movie kind of come to life. There's a scene at the end where, without giving anything away, it's kind of the final scene between father and son and
killer.
Son.
Got it.
Other favorite. My favorite.
That's, I mean, those are my top three. It's you and Ryan in the bar talking to your grown son, but you don't know he's your son. It's the farewell between husband and wife, and it's the father, son, where I remember we came in that day and we didn't do a lot of talking. We didn't do a lot of rehearsing. And I just remember feeling like, oh, this is ready. This is ready now. Let's grab something, let's roll. And again, not a lot of takes, but Mark, do you remember Mark on take one?
He just does that Mark thing.
Getting that front row seat with popcorn, getting to watch that was pretty amazing.
It's a beautiful scene, and I love you. So it was easy.
And so get ready to ugly cry when you watch this movie. Yeah, a lot of ugly crying.
It's like it's a fun escapist popcorn kind of movie, but it's also an ugly cry kind of
movie.
Yeah,
in the end.
It's going to punch you. Yes.
Yeah.
It's that great.
In the best, like, satisfying way.
It's Mary Pickford, right? Make them laugh, make them cry, but bring them back to laughter, right? You kind of like that form. Because we sort of end with Zoe and I having this sweet sort of moment together, which I think is really special.
Trusting fate that you know, and there's that beautiful bond between, you know, just like husband and wife, of like a good team. Like, no wonder they were pilots, no wonder they were partners. Is that thing of like, you will find me. She musters that strength to believe that they were meant to be together.
Well, there's some ideas in the movie that are so all of us yearn for.
Yeah.
Love that's meant to be.
Yes.
Forgiveness of your parents through understanding your parents and making peace with your former self. Like, all of us have been that kid wondering if everything's gonna be okay, and to see the outcome What a dream that would be. So yeah. This movie got to explore a lot of what I think are like collective human what ifs.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And Walker, you made me feel emotional watching your performance because you had this essence of like you were angry because that was your way of coping with pain. Like you captured that so beautifully. And I have three boys, so I'm learning so much day after day to know what they really mean when they say things that are just completely misrepresentative of what they feel. Yeah. And you captured that, and obviously you were guided beautifully, and you were mentored beautifully, but your performance was exceptional.
Feels like your 50th movie. I would never guess it was your first.
Like I said, they should have put baseball lessons in the contract.
Why is that? Oh, well, that's true.
For the most athletic kid on earth, yeah. Like, where's the baseball?
I can't catch a baseball.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. You can do, like, a triple flip in pike position backwards and land on your eyelash, but you can't throw a baseball.
I don't understand it either.
We found your kryptonite.
Good.
It's one thing.
It's good.
But then I had to learn how to throw it left-handed for another thing.
Oh, well, that's just cruel. That's mean,
actually. Yeah.
You need something to push against in life, so there you go. Yeah. Suck at something.
Now you've dealt with adversity.
Yeah.
I don't want to be here any more than you want me here. I just got to stop bleeding long enough. Address the wound, prevent a nasty infection. I will be on my merry way. Don't touch that.
I was just looking.
Don't touch my stuff.
Is this a lightsaber?
No, it's not a lightsaber. Okay. Enough with the bat already, all right? If I wanted to hurt you, I'd have done it already. Because if I'm being perfectly honest with myself, you have a very punchable face.
How are we separating Maddie and Jenna?
And you're on a couch, it should be the iconic
couch.
We're
rearranging. Let's go.
My goodness. There we go.
Yeah. There it is. Zoom in. Get that shot. Now the world's been given what they want. Jenna, Mark, what was that reunion like after all these years?
18 years.
So sweet.
It was so sweet.
We had traveled such a long journey.
And there's such a comfort of like feeling really known underneath all the trappings of life, but feeling actually really known.
Yeah, what's it like working together now versus then?
Coming home from a long journey.
Are you being silly? Because that's a really nice thing to say.
No, it was. We both started there. I mean, I felt that was the beginning for me.
Yeah, for me too, for sure.
And, you know, we were just kids.
And we had such an incredible, the whole process of making that movie, it felt like an independent.
Completely.
Was so little, but the process of making it and of rehearsing and improvising and improving the scenes and having a writer right there and then going back, that was really beautiful.
Well, that's a legacy piece of work.
So then we went and had kids and families and lives and careers and all this stuff happened, and then we came back.
I love that you came back as husband and wife.
And we came back as husband and wife.
In a very intimate scene.
Yes.
Yeah, and it felt so easy.
I love that scene.
It's like we picked up where they left off.
It kind of feels like Jenna and Maddie were married all this time,
amazing.
You know? And then they
amazing.
And it's so powerful. There's only one scene of you guys together, but we understand that Adam had it that great. Mm-hmm. When both his mom and dad were alive, like they loved each other, understanding loss from a child's perspective is what I guess moved me the most too. Mm-hmm. But you guys were phenomenal. Obviously, I was like,
thank you.
Jen's read of that is not a Denver omelet. That's a cry for help. It's still one of my favorites. Runs through my mind every time I make eggs.
There is a sequence that I thought of as my Endor sequence with the like Land Cruisers. I remember being so wowed by that sequence through the woods, and we had this chase scene, and it was supposed to just be a truck and a spaceship, and it wasn't interesting enough. So when we were prepping it, actually it was our stunt coordinator who said, "What else can we add to make it more exciting?" And he found on YouTube these guys who actually ride these hoverboard surfboards at high speed. And I said, "Can we actually do that for real?" and we did. And so it's really 50-50 digital and real. And we surfed these guys through the woods in British Columbia. But my happiest, kind of funniest memory is you guys shot on a green screen stage in a truck in front of green screen. And I remember being on a microphone, and because we needed to simulate the turns. So I'd go, 3, 2, 1, left!
And then
3, 2, and no one knew if it was my left or your left.
Everyone would go the wrong way.
Right. It's deceptively,
just physics,
it's harder
just out
than it
the
looks.
Window. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and us trying to figure out, like, if the truck is turning this way,
right.
Do we look that way or do we look this way? And yeah. we would always take like a hot minute kind of like figuring that out.
There's some very amusing bad takes of that while everyone's bodies are moving differently. But the magic of directing is if all you put in is the great parts, that's all the audience knows.
That's it.
Yeah. Well, this has been fun. It's been Entertainment Weekly's Around the Table with The Adam Project, which you can watch on Netflix March 11th.